Hello, and welcome to the Hope Connection. I'm your host, Harry Jackson. Today, we're continuing our series on the names of God. Have you ever been wronged, mistreated? Maybe you want to get back at the one who harmed you. Well, my friend, I've got good news for you. You're not alone, and you don't have to be in the mode of fighting every single battle. In fact, I believe that what God is doing in our generation is that He is in the business of defending, protecting, and advancing the cause of His beloved. Romans reminds us that vengeance belongs to the Lord and He shall repay. Today's teaching on Jehovah Gmolah, the Lord who rewards, will give you great insight on how you and I can handle these difficult situations. Now, walk with me today as we explore the difference between man's revenge and God's recompense. Remember, the book of James says that the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. So right now, I want you to turn to an obscure portion of Scripture in Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 55 through 57. Because the Lord hath spoiled Babylon and destroyed out of her the great voice, when her waves do roar like great waters, a noise of their voice is uttered, because the spoiler is come upon her, even upon Babylon, and her mighty men are taken. Every one of their bows is broken, for the Lord God of recompenses shall surely requite. And I will make drunk her princes and her wise men, her captains and her rulers and her mighty men, and they shall sleep a perpetual sleep and not wake, saith the King, whose name is the Lord of hosts. That is an amazing passage of Scripture. Now, imagine that God was talking to you and He's essentially saying, I'm going to hit you with my right hand, then I'm going to hit you with my left hand. You're going to be so tired and weak, you're not going to be able to put up your defenses. And then after I do all that, when you fall crashing to the ground, then I'm going to kick you and stomp you and beat you. That's in essence what is being prophetically declared to these people. And I believe that God is saying, because you mishandled and mistreated my people, I'm now, many years later, coming back to have my own vengeance upon you, says the Lord. Now, the name Jehovah Gmolah is given unto us in Jeremiah 51, 56, as you heard. Scholars tell us that God did what He spoke prophetically 70 years later to the Medes and the Persians. Now, this would have made an awesome movie. I can imagine something like Ben-Hur or some of those kinds of movies. But if you think about movies in our generation, and I happen to like old Westerns or action and adventure movies, but really there are three great movie themes that we see repetitively in our generation. They are simply rescue, redemption, and revenge. Let me repeat. They are rescue, people are in trouble, and the whole movie is about someone coming to their rescue, the different cycles of attempted rescue, and then ultimately the liberation or deliverance. A movie like Taken would be something that shows this rescue theme. Secondly, though, there is a movie that has a redemption-oriented theme. The redemption theme is usually a story about someone who is evil and misguided, but after a period of time, they come to a kind of epiphany in their lives, and then they return to a new and a different character dimension. Oftentimes, in some of the Westerns I've watched, there'd be stories of folks who were once gunslingers, bad guys, murderers, killers, who had settled down to a place of peace, and then all of a sudden, some trauma, some trouble comes to them and they come out. But as they come out and fight, they do it with a whole different changed character, that's where redemption comes in. And then finally, there is the old-fashioned revenge movie. And you'll find that Charles Bronson years ago had all these movies about being an urban vigilante, and he was after the bad guys who the laws couldn't get. Rescue, redemption, and revenge. Now, I believe Romans 12, 19 through 21 tells us the attitude we should have. Even though those themes make great movies, we should not have get your back. We should not have an eye for an eye kind of mentality. We should be forgiving, but knowing that God himself is going to fight the battle for us. Listen to this. Do not avenge yourselves, beloved, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Listen to those words. Overcome evil with good. In other words, if you were to analyze that passage, it's essentially saying, do things that you know are good for those who have hurt you. And if there is a judgment and an administrative measure of justice that needs to be meted out, let God handle it. Let God do it. You stay in the place of forgiveness. Now, the definition of recompense is to make amends to someone for loss or harm suffered to compensate. It means compensation or reward given for loss or harm suffered or effort made. Let's remember that synonyms to this would be compensate, reward, remunerate, repay, requite, requital, compensation, reward, remuneration. In other words, we serve the God of the payback. If there is something that needs to be given back to those who have mistreated you, then God will handle it. The justice of God, those wheels of God's justice, grind slowly, but they grind fine. They move sometimes in a very, very slow manner, but God looks at these things. I want to share something very challenging with you in the remaining moments of this segment, and that's this. One of the great problems that many minority people have in our generation is that they feel as though their family, their fathers and fathers have been abused, and they carry a residual anger and unforgiveness towards society, systems, people who are wealthy. There's even a class-oriented sense of revenge that many people have. The problem with holding on to that attitude is you actually block the justice of God from coming into play. God wants to make a difference in your life. In 2 Samuel chapter 21, there's a story there of David in which he is praying about why there is a drought in his land in his day as king. As he prays for the third year in a row, in other words, things have been going well, and then they go into this time of drought and famine. God says, it's because of the Gibeonites. In other words, God says, your previous king, who you're not related to, messed up. And he did some inhumane things to the Gibeonites. And I, God, am requiring you, David, to make it right because I am a just God. And without going into the totality of that story right now, we simply say that when David got it right, God broke the power of the drought. He broke the power of famine and released the blessing upon his people. In other words, he moved as the God of recompense and justice. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Whenever good news is slow in coming, when bad circumstances don't seem to improve, when we feel forsaken and powerless, Bishop Jackson wants you to know that the change you long for can be yours. For a donation of $25 or more, we will send you this inspirational book titled, You Were Born for More. Discover 6 steps to breaking through to your destiny. Bishop Jackson teaches you to open the pathway to blessings, draw closer to Christ, how to grow in love and endurance, and how you can experience the favor of God. Call right now. The number is 240-845-0388 or go to the website at thehopeconnection.org. If you would like to write us, the address is on the screen. God wants us to experience His love, to be a light to the world, and this book will guide you in that purpose. You will believe again and discover that you were truly born for more.
Welcome back. I believe we've had an interesting message so far. I hear all the time questions like this. What should I do? Should I take this unbeliever to court? Should I fight for my rights? And we're living in an American culture that is over-litigated. It is antagonistic. If you're in a stop sign or a stop light in the Washington, D.C. area, and the light changes, all of a sudden, people are in a hurry to get where they want to get, and they'll almost push you out of the way and be overly aggressive in their actions. But how do we handle the fact that we serve a God who says that He's in charge of the universe and He's backing you? That whoever blesses you will be blessed, whoever curses you will be cursed. That's the Deuteronomy covenant, and that's the promise that we have from God. So I believe we're going to have to walk in love, but there are times when we sacrifice and give to God, expecting that He's watching over what we've lost or gave up. Listen to a very lengthy passage of Scripture from Hebrews 11. I'm going to read about 3 verses, stop for a moment, and continue on. But this is the story of Moses. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians are saying to do, were drowned, end of quote. Now, I believe this is a powerful passage of Scripture that we've got to think about. Essentially, it says this. Moses never fully identified with the position, the privilege, and the possibilities of being an Egyptian king. History tells us that he was trained as a medical doctor, a general. He also had amazing exposure to the greatest culture and the most powerful nation of the world. But all through this lifetime, his mother, who became his nursemaid by a rare turn of God's circumstances, put it in his heart that one day you're going to be delivered for your people. And so he was involved in looking out for his folks. He gave up some things. And the idea of the passage we just read to you is this, that God paid attention to Moses. If Moses had been just another Pharaoh, we wouldn't be talking about him today. He would have been one of those many names that we know nothing about. But because he took the path least followed and he identified with his people, God allowed his name to be the hallmark of Jewish tradition and a Jewish deliverer. And he became the most powerful man in his generation because of the move of God and his fidelity to God's agenda. So God paid him back long term for what he sowed short term. God will do that for you. Doing the right thing will always bring a righteous reward. Listen to this additional passage from Proverbs chapter 12, verse 13 through 15, a much shorter version or segment of scripture. The wicked is snared by the transgression of his lips, but the just shall come out of trouble. A man shall be satisfied with good by the fruit of his mouth, and the recompense of a man's hand shall be rendered unto him. That's really powerful. That passage simply means, as there is the heart-mouth continuum, it's talking about what comes out of our mouth, often reflects what's in our hearts. As we watch, nurture our heart to think and to say the right thing, and we do correspondingly the right thing, God will allow grace, goodness, blessing to be returned to us. No matter how they treated you on your last job, no matter how you were treated in your first marriage, God is saying to us, this is the hour that I want to restore and renew to my faithful ones and restore and return blessings upon them. Think about this from Matthew chapter 19, verse 29. And everyone that hath forsaken houses or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive an hundredfold and shall inherit everlasting life. This is the principle of recompense. God is saying, I double dog dare you. That's old fashioned terminology. For you to give up something that's truly for my sake, my kingdom, my name. Watch if I won't just give you back what you gave up, but I'll multiply whatever you think you lost temporarily 100 times. That's what happened with Moses, and that was the promise that Jesus was giving to his disciples. He's saying, you're operating in kingdom reality now, boys. I need you to believe me when I say you cannot outgive God, and whatever you sow will return back to you 100-fold. Mark chapter 10, verse 29 says, truly I tell you, Jesus replied, no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel, no one will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. That is a corresponding promise. That promise, just the same as the one in Mark, is an amazing passage. But it tells us that God is watching over our lives and he's looking at what we invest. There's a cost of discipleship. We've heard that. There's a book written about the life of Dietrich Bonhoeffer that talks about the great price of discipleship. But in these scriptures, it's saying to us in our generation that no matter what being a disciple of Jesus costs you, there will be an overwhelming ROI, return on investment, that's going to come back to you. You can't outgive God. I keep saying it. You don't have to fight your own battles. You don't have to be someone who feels like, I don't like what you're doing, God. My enemies have gotten away with things that they've done to me. I wish I could tell you, if time would permit, for me to tell you several stories about God supernaturally intervening in my behalf, on our ministry's behalf, over millions of dollars, things that seemed so lost, causes that we felt like we could not ever recover from. But time and time again, God said, you temporarily gave up something, but on the long haul, I multiplied back to you more than what you sowed because of my commitment to my will and to your faithfulness. You are on the verge of stepping up to a higher level, walking in the power of forgiveness and love, and God is going to make a way for you. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after this break.
Whenever good news is slow in coming, when bad circumstances don't seem to improve, when we feel forsaken and powerless, Bishop Jackson wants you to know that the change you long for can be yours. For a donation of $25 or more, we will send you this inspirational book titled, You Were Born for More. Discover 6 steps to breaking through to your destiny. Bishop Jackson teaches you to open the pathway to blessings, draw closer to Christ, how to grow in love and endurance, and how you can experience the favor of God. Call right now. The number is 240-845-0388 or go to the website at thehopeconnection.org. If you would like to write us, the address is on the screen. God wants us to experience His love, to be a light to the world, and this book will guide you in that purpose. You will believe again and discover that you were truly born for more.
Welcome back. I hope you found some things that I was sharing with you worthy of your taking notes from today's message. Remember, the compound name of God we're studying today is Jehovah Gmolah, the Lord who rewards. Now, I believe that we have got to review this. Number one, definition of what recompense is, meaning God is going to give back to you what you have walked in, what you've sown in His name. If you've sown good seed, you're going to get good things back. But even if you have been harmed because of a sacrificial stance that you had to take, God says, I'm not going to leave you in a deficit position. I'm going to make up and then multiply back to you more than anything you've lost. Second major principle for us is that we saw the principle of recompense through the life of Moses. Moses gave up the status, the stature, the position of being Pharaoh, the most powerful person in the known world of his day. And he received from God the blessing of leading his people out of Egyptian captivity into the promised land, and then his spiritual legacy, the glory of his name, if you would, was greater than anything he would have ever have seen if he had remained in the office of Pharaoh. And then I want you to look at the concept of recompense with me. I think that's really very, very important. We have to untie God's hands. Think about it this way. God wants to defend or fight for us, but we untie His hands to protect us when we don't protect ourselves. If I fuss, fight, throw a tantrum, act up on my own behalf, then God's hands are tied. There's a spiritual dimension where we have to put these things in the hands of God. And there's so many ways we could talk about that, but I think you've got this idea. Concerning race relations in America today, I believe we're about to see a great awakening in the land. I believe that African Americans and Asians and Hispanic believers are going to begin to see God restore and bring them to the forefront in a most amazing way. The principle of restoration in the book of Joel God said, I will restore the years that the canker worm and caterpillar have eaten. I believe that's coming as we learn how to forgive, untying the hands of God. But none of that works unless we're born again first. You really can't forgive to the fullness unless you've received Jesus. So I want you to pray a prayer with me, prayer of salvation. Repeat this prayer with me if you don't mind. Heavenly Father, that's it, just repeat that. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and I asked him to come into my heart and to be Lord of my life right now. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, then I believe you are born again. And I want to reach out to you, and I want you to call me on the number you'll see on your screen. We want to give you some tools that will help you in this Christian walk. And for more information, you want to go to our website, thehopeconnection.org. That's thehopeconnection.org. Or join us on our Facebook page, Grow with Hope. Better yet, if you're in the D.C. area, we'd love to see you on Sunday morning. Join us at our Beltsville campus at 6251 Ammondale Road, right off Route 1. And we are having an amazing time, joy, all kinds of intergenerational activity, young and old worshiping together. It's an amazing group of people. And we're saving a seat just for you. Look forward to seeing you. And I thank God that we'll be here again at this very same time next week.
Thank you for joining Bishop Jackson today. The preceding program has been brought to you by the partners and friends of the Hope Connection. For more information, please visit our website at www.thehopeconnection.org. Join us next week for an exciting adventure into God's Word.